See, it's not that we know all the answers, right? Like, everybody is learning through the process. That's where the journey part comes in, right? But all of this is fantastic examples of how people are married to the larger aspiration and compromised on shorter materialistic goals. And in the long term, actually, they all gained much more than what they would have gained otherwise, is my feeling. Things that I'm going to talk about are four ideas, like progress, trust, mindset, and journey. There is a specific reason I'm putting progress instead of success. The problem is progress is much more motivating because it takes you from point A to point B. And success seems to be more definitive, and it doesn't seem to give you the leeway to sort of design your own goals and stuff like that, right? So that's one of the reasons I thought I'd put progress instead of success. How do we do progress? In especially, I'm talking primarily in the work context. For me, if you really look at how things progress from point A to point B in a positive way, this is fundamentally built on two simple ideas. One idea is about clarity, whether we know what we are doing. And the second idea is trust. When you combine clarity, which is we know what we are doing and where we are heading, at all levels, right? At my level, falling down to all my direct reports, the BU heads, the chapter leads, and then from there, going to the individual product owners, marketing owners, from there to the team members, right? If that clarity percolates down from the top to the end, that makes a tremendous difference. And one of our tools to make the clarity happen is our OKR model, right? And then the second component is trust, and we'll talk more about it. And when you combine clarity and trust together, you basically achieve progress in a work environment and trust. And even this would applicable even in your personal context, family context, and outside of work as well, right? Trust is very, 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 very important in a team play. And you know, you can't be second guessing each other. When you combine clarity and trust, you end up in progress. Now, what is trust, right? If you look at trust itself, we have talked about it in the past in limited groups, in a smaller groups. I've been reading a book about Stephen Covey's Jr. I think it's called Speed of Trust or something like that. That was very, very enlightening for me to understand how trust is not just about honesty, being genuine, being trust, you know, all of that stuff, which is normally character attributes, right? But trust is a combination of both character attributes as well as competence attributes. And when you combine character and competence, you end up in trust. You know, the classic example is like if you go to a doctor, he needs to be good in his job, but he should also be good in terms of not fleecing you, charging you, overcharging you, not. Because doctors, for example, can scare you and grab a lot of money from you, right? That pretty much defines the character attribute. Competence is about good in their job, whether it's surgery or diagnosis, whatever it is. But to trust a doctor, I'm taking doctor example because most of the time we end up in this situation, right? When somebody's sick at home, you go through your network and find out who's a trustable doctor. And what you're really looking for is not just somebody who's really good in their job, but also good in their job, plus they have a trustable character, right? So it's a combination of just character alone won't cut it. You're not really looking for a good person who doesn't know how to do surgery, right? That kind of a doctor you anyway don't need. You need character, plus you also need competence, right? When you combine these two things, you end up in trust. And trust happens, trust is so fundamental. And at work, it's a very, very core ingredient, right? Now, how do you put all these three things in perspective? If you really look at it, it is like a pyramid, right? The pyramid of the three C's, character, competence, clarity, right? If you have all the three things, right, you make progress, which means you can grow the company, you can achieve milestones. Progress is more important because success is different things for different people, right? But progress is universal. Basically, you're basically growing from point A to point B. That is a universal phenomenon. When you have all the three, you get progress, and you get just the two, you just result in trust, right? So this is a very simpler mental picture that you can keep in mind. Okay, and some of the nuances you might want to understand in trust in these three slides is trust does not need on clarity. If you really look at it, if you have to trust someone, you don't need to have clarity. In fact, if you trust someone, you can gain clarity by trusting someone, talk to them, understand more, and stuff like that. So that's a very, very important thing to understand, right? The other thing is about clarity, right? The other thing about clarity is sometimes you feel people like, you know, me or even other senior members of the team, right? They tend to have more clarity simply because they have access to information. They have a point of view. They are in a point of position from which they have a lot more information. And clarity is not necessarily about intelligence, right? It's intelligence combined with a lot of knowledge that you can process, and you can connect the dots, and you can make meaning with that. And when somebody, and if you don't have all that information, sometimes you may not have clarity. So that is why when you have trust, you can actually talk to people who have all those vantage points and get that clarity, and then actually make progress. And the other thing that you need to look at it is, one of the difficult things to assess between trust in the trust combination, character and competence, is character, because it is very relatively easy to assess competency, especially interviews mostly catch it. At Kisflow, we tend to, you know, invest a lot of time in doing this, understanding the person's character, alignment, and everything with the company's culture and core values, and that's where we have instituted the culture test. But it is still very, very difficult to, you know, figure out that, and it takes a long time for us to understand that. Okay, I think we need to go a little bit understand this, and because competence is somewhat like a hygiene factor, because it gets assessed even before you sort of join a company. The emphasis in the trust combination of character and competence is more on the character part, because you need to have competence anyway to get inside a company. But what is sometimes very difficult to assess is character. So I think we need to spend a lot. The reason why we are investing a lot of time in culture and all of that is because we are trying to, A, first of all, get people in who are aligned with our culture. B, once they are aligned in, they are a Kisflowite, right? Once they are a Kisflowite, we want to continue to invest in whoever comes in and shape their thought process and awareness, and give knowledge and information so that they can become better persons, because nobody is perfect, right? And you know, I have learned a lot in the last 15 years, and I wanted to see how we can give that same opportunity to everyone. And also competence, you can quickly assess on day-to-day interactions, and you know, how someone is presenting an idea, speaking about a problem, or coming up with a solution, so all of these things, right? And you know, you can easily assess the day-to-day interactions, but character attributes are revealed over a long period of time. The most important thing about character attributes are how people react during tough times, difficult times, because in good times, everybody will be doing well, right? It is during the tough times how you react pretty much defines who your person is and what your character is, right? And that's the important thing. And sometimes, you know, like we tend to be confuse character with behaviors. Like when I say behavior, I mean, like sometimes people might behave as if they are compliant, or they are listening to you, or basically they're going to follow your instructions and, you know, or just agree with you. All of this is behavioral aspect, which you'll probably see it on the surface level, right? But character attributes are much more deeper. There is one thing that I used to say: it is okay to believe that you are smart, but it is actually not okay to believe the other person is stupid, right, or fool. The reason I'm saying this is, when we are faking our behaviors, we think that we have succeeded it and we have done a good job of masking and, you know, cheating the other person in front of us. But invariably, pretty much, I can tell you, everyone just knows if you are faking it, right? So we have to be very clear And we have to be genuine in terms of what we think and be direct and honest as much as possible, right? See, there is generally people a little bit exaggerate, and we tend to, like, that's there in the human psyche, like in general. But we tend to make character judgments on people just because they said something, you know, they exaggerated something. You know, especially if you, when it comes to sales, for example, people are bullish and they sort of commit to certain numbers and they feel that they closed this particular deal and stuff like that. And they're saying, meaning salespeople need to learn the art of predicting and projecting numbers accurately. There is no excuse of it. That will reflect on their competence. But we should not sort of use that to determine their character because their intention is not to sort of, you know, cheat us or mislead us, but is to like be bullish and, you know, go after it and stuff like that, right? So I'm just giving that as an example. And this kind of exaggeration sort of happens in all functions, like even product teams. Like they'll basically, they might have a lot more things going on, but they might end up promising, okay, this June we will deliver something, right? And but basically they're going bullish about it. They're not cheating or lying or anything like that. They're just a little bit optimistic, and that's a kind of a bit exaggeration, right? And these are a couple of examples I'm saying. But this kind of example, this kind of things happens throughout the world. And sometimes when we don't like someone, we pick these examples as a way to point out that about a character, about a person. So we need to be very careful about such things, right? I generally tend to overlook those mild, exaggerations that people look at it, because they're harmless things, as long as they're harmless things, right? We shouldn't really harp on minute flaws that people have and make character judgments based on that. And that's one of the, that naturally comes, takes us to LSD, because one of the reasons that we are doing LSD is actually an awareness program for self, right? And character is all about self. It's a self-introspection. And LSD basically builds your character, increases awareness, it increases your introspection, and it takes you beyond competence and results. It makes you a better person, better individual, better human being, not just at work, but also at your with your family, with your spouse and kids and everyone. So I think that's, I'm very, very happy that we are doing this program because of that, right? And the other concept that I want to talk about is there are three parts. One is progress, trust, we talked about it, and trust, we went into details about character attributes specifically, because competence you understand very well. So that's one bucket. The second bucket is the concept of success versus journey. Like, I've seen a lot of people who have goals like, you know, I want to achieve something as a very fixed goal. And sometimes that becomes very, very difficult when they don't do that, right? It's pretty demotivating. So I always believe, meaning this is what I do it for myself, right? I always play by my own rules. I'm sort of a little bit like a rebel, right? I don't want to comply to what everyone says is the measure of success. I want to create my own rules and play by my own definitions of what success is to me, or what. And if you do that, then I start enjoying the journey, and I don't get heartburns or stress or anything like that. And that's really what you think you should do. Especially as individuals, we shouldn't get carried away by what the friends are doing and copy them and try to become like them, right? And this is a famous example, right? We know a fish can't climb, but can beat anybody, many others in water, right? You know, because each one of us are made special, made in different ways, and we're special in different ways. And this is true for companies as well, right? Each company is made with a unique set of combinations, and we should not try to copy or imitate and compare another company and say, when are we going to become like that? And that would be very detrimental for us, because that will make us very demotivated. That will make us the whole journey very difficult, right? And we should have our own rules and our own game and our own playbook, right, which we will play by. And the fourth point is more aspirational goals versus four and five are pretty much the flips, the opposite side of each other, right? if you have very materialistic goals, like for example, you want to, you know, have, you know, 10 lakh salary or 15 lakh salary or 25 lakh salary or something like that. If you have materialistic goals, it will be very demotivating for you. Instead, when you have an aspirational goals, like think about Ilaiyaraaja as a music director or A.R. Rahman as a music director. If they thought to themselves that they want to charge 1 crore for a movie or 5 crores for a movie, if they make music, that is like having a materialistic goal. They don't have such goals. They only want to make fantastic, amazing, long-lasting music, right? So that's a very aspirational goal. And when you have that aspirational goals, it keeps makes you keep going, especially during tough times. And it is never demotivating. But when you have a goal like I want to charge 1 crore for a movie, and you'll be able to see you're not achieved it. And if you're not achieved it, it'll be very demotivating. And you think you want to give up because you think that you're not achieved it and you're not succeeded it. And then you want to give up and you won't go farther, right? And this is one of the things that actually keeps me going all the time, right? So, for example, I wanted to build the greatest company in Chennai, right? And I want to build that company which is headquartered in Chennai rather than build a billion-dollar company. So, once you say it's a billion-dollar company, it's very demotivating, right? Because... but when you say we want to build the greatest company headquartered in Chennai, that's very much more inclusive, expansive, and accommodating, right? So that keeps me motivated continuously to go forward. So that's a closest example that I can give here. And finally, the last side, one of the challenges that most of you face, especially in work, is having a scarcity mindset, right? I actually believe there is a lot in abundance mindset than scarcity mindset. Like you compete with your peers, your colleagues, instead of partnering with them if you have scarcity mindset. If you have abundance mindset, you think about your peers and colleagues as partners, right? The classic examples are, you really look at these two gentlemen, right? They've been with the company for quite some time. They have roughly exactly same skills, same capability, same level of commitment, same color of passion. And they're in some sense, you can think of them as competitors, but they never thought about themselves as competitors. They've always thought themselves as partners. And they've grown so well. And because they never thought that each one is going to take away anyone else's job or anything like that. Once they start thinking like that, then it becomes a scarcity mindset. They always felt there is enough space for both of them to learn and grow. And that is actually the truth as well, right? And once you have that abundance mindset, you don't see people as competing with you. You see people as, partners who you can collaborate with. Unfortunately, this scarcity mindset comes to us from childhood days, right? Because we want to, there is limited amount of engineering seats, there is limited amount of medical seats, so we need to compete, score 200, get that seat. So everything is less, right? And somehow if you can get out of that scarcity mindset, especially it's rooted to us from childhood days, this will actually help a lot at work, right? And also the abundance and scarcity mindset thinks about opportunities as unlimited possibilities versus limited opportunities, right? And this is so much true in work. Like for example, when she was working in solutions team and she was taking care of training and development, and from her vantage point she probably wouldn't have thought that it is possible for her to go and work as a product manager in the product, for example, right? Because like that is not visible to her. But if you really look at it, it is quite possible that those kind of things are quite possible. It is outside the realm of what you can imagine. You just have to be open and be true and committed to what you're doing, and eventually there will be a lot of opportunities that will crop up, especially if you're living in a culture that is pretty well laid out culture. Like hopefully we believe that this flow is one. You will actually eventually get to do whatever will benefit your career, right? So that's pretty much what I wanted to say. So progress, trust, competence, character, success versus journey, abundance and scarcity mindset. That's all I have, folks. Thank you very much.